think we're not yet in a moment where we can see strong growth coming from GDP numbers in Brazil, but definitely it's a very positive macro environment right now.
Oscar Decotelli is the co-founder and CEO of DXA Investments, a Brazilian private equity firm. He has been in this industry for over two decades, and I managed to catch up with Oscar from his offices in the US. I asked him for his views on the Brazilian investment landscape, the consumer market and e-commerce, along with the potential in logistics.
Logistics in Brazil, just to give you an idea, it's about 12% of the GDP, so give or take about $240 billion.
And his thoughts on economic sectors presenting future opportunities, including fintech and agtech.
I think the fintech revolution has been a phenomenal revolution for the country because, and this has been driven not just by technology, but also by very positive government regulation readjustments, let's say.
So the first question I want to ask you, Oscar, really is to talk about the Brazilian business landscape and the general investment environment. Brazil is just coming out slowly from a recession, 2015-16 sort of era, but the economy isn't exactly steaming along. So tell me how you see the business landscape and investment environment as it is today.
Well, thank you very much for the opportunity to be here on this podcast. Brazil has been coming from a process that really started in 1994 when it started to control inflation and not really just this recent history of leaving the recession 2015-16. Brazil was able to start in 1994 an economic policy that has been followed by governments from right wing and left wing, and it brought the country to the situation where it is today, which is a very positive and stable economic background with a very low interest rate and low inflation. But that said, Brazil is a country that still has a lot of structural changes to be done. And that's probably the main reason why we are not seeing a very strong growth in these last years. Fortunately, this new government is working to get such structural changes approved. The most important of them right now is a social security reform, which is on its track to get approved. Mm-hmm. And this social security reform, it's probably going to be the biggest fiscal restructuring that Brazil has lived in its modern economy. So I think we're not yet in a moment where we can see strong growth coming from GDP numbers in Brazil, but definitely it's a very positive macro environment right now.
Why do you think this, because we're talking here about the pension reform, I believe. Why do you think this has taken so long and what's been holding it up?
Probably that's one of the most difficult structural changes that a country can go through, right? Because from a political standpoint, for you to change what people are going to receive in their retirement years and some of these laws, they need a very strong number of congressmen and senators to vote. So you need to have an ideal political moment where politicians are able to vote in a vast majority in a very unpopular measure. So I think that's probably the biggest reason why it wasn't able to be done before. So with this new government, the Bolsonaro government in the beginning of this year, they came with this view that this is the biggest needed reform that the country has to be able to deliver. So I think that's probably the main reason why we were able to do it right now.
And so given that this is likely to move through, how do you view the economic outlook then and the investment outlook for Brazil in the next 2 to 3 years?
I think we will see interesting capital movements into the country. What we have seen in these last, almost 12 months now, has been a lot of local Brazilians buying the stock exchange. We've seen a very strong price appreciation for the stocks, but predominantly has been local money. We haven't seen positive FDI flows yet. So I believe that once this reform is finally done, we will start to see dramatic moves of capital from international flows into the country. So I think we're waiting to see the reform actually getting approved, not just the promise of it.
Sure. And I want to speak specifically about foreign investment shortly, but just before I do, just to touch on a point you mentioned there about local money Brazilians buying into the stock exchange. Generally speaking, are Brazilians shareholders?
Yes, generally speaking, they're Brazilian shareholders, yes. Brazil is one of the countries that has of its lowest savings percentage. So we're coming from a very low base when you think about savings in the country. So it's not historically a reality, but it's starting to become more and more. And part of the price appreciation has this whole new flow of investors that had never held a stock before that are now investing into it. The low interest rates environment that Brazil is living right now, its lowest interest rates in history, is creating a momentum of local Brazilian investors starting to maintain their savings into investments, into alternative investments. So although Brazil has not been historically a country with a large percentage of savings, it's starting to grow more and more. When you look in regards to the fund industry, locally, the fund industry, mutual funds, hedge funds in Brazil, we're talking about a $1 trillion industry. So there's a lot of capital already allocated to funds and to investments alternatives, but there's a lot more that needs to come in through savings.
Before we go on to other topics, I'd like to just continue on talking about the consumer class in Brazil. Is there a growing sort of consumer class in Brazil, a growing middle class? Can you sort of describe that a little bit to me?
Definitely, yes. Brazil's middle class growth follows the same process as we've seen in other emerging market countries, with the lower class individuals starting to be able to acquire products they've never acquired before. And it really, Brazil's largest growth of the middle class was from 2005, 2006, all the way to 2012, 13, where we had a very big percentage of the population emerging. So today, middle class is about 55% of the population, which is a big mass of people. We're talking about more than 110, 120 million people. Mm-hmm. And what we're seeing now is a process of them developing their consumer taste, as if we might say. So instead of just acquiring the basic, straightforward, in the beginning, food-related consumer products such as TVs and electronics, now they're evolving towards using more credit cards, using smartphones, using e-commerce. So we're seeing growth in these sectors in spite of the recession. So e-commerce growth, for instance, has been double digit since 2010. So even during 2014, 2015, and 2016 were very difficult economic years. We saw e-commerce with double digit growth. So I think there are some pockets of opportunities that are definitely related to this new consumer taste and this consumer patterns.
E-commerce is an interesting one because Amazon is now present in Brazil, but there are a couple of big local e-commerce giants there. Can you tell us a little bit about the competitive nature of the industry there?
Yeah, it's a great topic because it's not just very interesting, but it's also a great investment opportunity sector. So Amazon is indeed present in Brazil as a firm, trying to increase. They've just launched their Prime now, but still something that's very shy. And the biggest reason why we've seen cases of companies like, you have two great examples. companies like Netshoes and companies like Magazine Luiza, where you've seen one being completely hit on a negative standpoint for its logistics inability, and therefore the whole stock has dropped 80-90% since IPO.
Right.
And while the other one, Magazine Luiza, has been able to use their physical stores as an ideal logistics framework to create a marketplace, and its stocks has grown dramatically also. So we have two very interesting cases that show that the biggest component of e-commerce on a large scale in Brazil will be your ability to resolve the logistics issues. Brazil is a country that has less than 14% of the roads are paved. So if you want to do a national solution, it needs to have logistics embedded into such solution.
Transport infrastructure in Brazil. And Brazil doesn't have natural waterways for shipping goods. It doesn't have a rail network. So a lot of it relies on trucks to get around the country. I know that DXA invested in a company called Modern Logistics. Perhaps you could talk to me about the nature of logistics infrastructure in Brazil and what meaningful developments or transitions are taking place. How is technology being used, or how should it be used to disrupt the sector?
Yes, it's a great point. Brazil consumer trends and patterns is not very different than what we've seen in other countries around the world. So what we will see is, and I sometimes make fun, I say it's like we have a crystal ball because we can see what happened in the US, what happened in other countries, and that's going to happen there also. But when we look in regards to the infrastructure available in order to allow a straightforward, only pure technology disruption, the infrastructure simply is not there. So when we look at cases like Alibaba in China or even Amazon in the US, both of them used the infrastructure that already existed, either through U.S. Postal Service or through the Chinese government's infrastructure investments. And they were able to create solutions that were based on technology, but they were leveraging off an infrastructure that existed. That's not the case in Brazil. There's infrastructure in the southeast, but in the middle of the country and in the northeast, it's simply not connected. As I mentioned, there's less than 14% of the roads are paved. And the situation that we live today is that while when we discuss about long-haul trucking in the U.S., we're talking roughly about 100 miles, it's long-haul trucking. In Brazil, we're talking about 10,000 kilometers. So what we see is a situation of a country that's very heavily dependent on trucking. And there's more than 3 million different trucking companies that can be from mom and pop shops that have like one truck or two trucks to larger structures, larger companies that have thousands of trucks. So what we do see is that the solution in order to be able to have a true national resolution or a national solution for logistics, it needs to be private because it's going to take decades and decades for the government to be able to invest to create the roads or the waterways or the railroads needed in order for someone like a Alibaba, Amazon, or another big player. The lack of infrastructure from a public standpoint, from a government supplied standpoint, made us view that the solution needed to be private. So we met in 2014, Gerald Lee, who was the founder of Modern Logistics, and this CEO, he was originally from JetBlue, went down to Brazil to start Azul Airlines, which is a very successful passenger airline. And when he saw this same opportunity set, the same lack of infrastructure, he saw that the solution for logistics needed to be a one-stop shop firm that could offer from warehouse to trucking, but that it owned its own airline. Because if you own your own airline, you're able to structure specific solutions for a client's needs, that you can't do that by just using the empty space on the belly of the of a passenger airline plane. So what he decided to do was to create modern logistics in the same situation, similar to a Blue Dart in India or a YTO, or even in the US, FedEx, supply chain solutions. So the idea was that through servicing large industrial clients that are already shifting products all across the country, logistics in Brazil, just to give you an idea, it's about 12% of the GDP, so give or take about $240 billion. So it's a very big market.
Oh, right.
So the idea was that once you start tapping with these large industrial clients to create a X for the country, then you would be able to create on top of that marketplaces and in essence cut the middleman that exists in so many different sectors because of this lack of infrastructure. And that's what happened with Model Logistics. We invested in the company almost 4 years ago. And since then, they started to offer their products. They started flying. They started to shift products. They today, their reach is a reach that allows to be delivered to about 4,500 cities in the country. So we're talking about roughly 99% of the country that is their current reach. And they have solutions that now go around the whole country. So what we see as a opportunity set in the country is being able to offer solutions that they won't be very similar or just like what happened in the international cases, because it will be dependent on what kind of infrastructure currently exists. So yes, we do believe Amazon Prime is the future, just like as we see it in the US, but it needs to have a very strong logistics solution. And that logistics solution won't be of simply relying on what the government has made, because unfortunately the country doesn't have a public infrastructure solution. So I think that's how we see the opportunity set. There are definitely cases of last mile solutions of companies being worth billions, more than $1 billion nowadays. And we think that this is probably one of the biggest opportunities that we could ever see in this decade.
Something DXA talks about is a significant capital reallocation to South America. Can you explain what you mean by that? And of course, what sectors you think are looking positive over the next 3 to 5 years?
The world is living right now a very interesting moment of having more than $15 trillion allocated to negative yield bonds, right? So we're living a very, in a way, risky moment, but also a moment that's pre-capital reallocation, in my view. When we see the impacts of the 2008 crisis, we've seen a big inflow of capital towards China, towards larger GDP growth number, emerging markets, and we've seen that in a big allocation from global mutual funds, fixed income mutual funds, equity mutual funds. And these funds, they will continue to have a mandate of allocating towards global markets. But when we see the percentage that most of these funds have towards LATAM is less than 2%. And LATAM is almost 10% of the global GDP. So that big gap between the representation of global economy versus the representation into major global allocators, we think that that's going to change. And we think that this is going to change towards LATAM, where we think that we will see more and more a outflow of capital from Asia and China going towards more normal levels of allocation there. And that money is going to be driven more towards LATAM. Which sectors we will see? And I think we are seeing definitely a search for sectors that are more resilient. And we're talking about food related, and that can be agriculture, that can be consumer food related type of companies. Mm-hmm. We are seeing also a strong flow or interest towards healthcare. we see through our financial solutions. And when we see opportunities in Latin America, and definitely it's true for Brazil, but it's true for other countries in Latin America also, the lack of basic solutions that now we see in the developed world, in the financial side, in the health side, in the food side, we think that that's going to drive a lot of the allocation. Brazil, just to give you an idea, today is the second largest food exporter in the world, and the UN's FAO expects to become the number one in a couple of years because there's still a lot of arable land, not taking account into the Amazon, just simply kind of a arable land that can be used. And we think that that's going to drive a lot of the capital inflows into the country in this sector.
So you mentioned a couple of sectors there, which I really want to dig into a little bit from the perspective of technology, fintech and agtech. What movements do you see happening in those particular sectors in Brazil? And what is the future for those two specifically in Brazil?
I think the fintech revolution has been a phenomenal revolution for the country because, and this has been driven not just by technology, but also by very positive government regulation readjustments, let's say. The government has allowed for institutions, that non-banking institutions, to operate as banks. And this is a process that now, if you and I want to open a fintech, it's a very straightforward, easy process. And what I believe is that we will see lots and lots of solutions that are fintech related, either through credit or through new banking solutions or through credit cards. We will see this happen all across the different sectors in the consumer space also. So you might see retailers having more of their fintechs, their internal fintechs, and there's a lot of white label fintech solutions in the country nowadays. And I think this is something that's only at the tip, only at the start. Mm-hmm. We still have a very big percentage of the population that does not have a bank account. And I think those are going to be more and more included into the national economy. Mm-hmm. In regards to agriculture, I believe that Brazil is in a multi-decade trend that won't change. This is related to food security. The world needs to produce more proteins. There's a multiplier effect over grains. Every kilo of beef takes up 10 to 12 kilos of grains. Every kilo of poultry takes 5 to 7 kilos of grains. When we look related to fuel that use, in the US, it uses corn base. So there's also a demand for biofuels that are using grains for that. So what we will see is more and more is the growth of production of grains. And Brazil is probably still the number one ideal place for you to do agriculture in large scale. There's a lot of availability of land. There's already infrastructure there. All the major global players are already in the country, so you're able to take the products internationally. Land price is very affordable still, so I think we will see agriculture still kind of pushing Brazil towards this larger position in the world. We've seen some projections. There's an interesting projection from Price Waterhouse that shows that Brazil is going to be the fifth largest country from a GDP standpoint in a couple of decades. And most of that is driven by this agriculture tsunami that Brazil is able to bring to the world.
Brazil has historically been known as quite a protectionist country. Can you speak to the nature of Brazil's international trade? And the particular trade partner that I want to highlight is, of course, China. Can you speak to the nature of that relationship?
Of course, Brazil and China. China is Brazil's largest trade partner. And China's demand for, let's say, agricultural products and food-related, this won't change. China has changed from a manufacturing economy to a consumption economy, and then that has affected a lot of its relationships with countries that are providers of manufactured goods or that demand their manufactured goods. And I think this is in the core of the issues related between China and the U.S., current trade tensions. But when we look related to Brazil, the demand for grains, oil, iron ore, these kind of demands, they are a multi-decade type of trends that won't just simply change right now. So China has a need for what Brazil has to offer, and in a way for what South America in general has to offer, especially while you don't have a lot of infrastructure going on in Africa, for instance, that would allow Africa to be a big provider of natural goods to the world. So South America will continue to be that way. What we see between China and Brazil is a relationship that had its ups and downs, especially when we see around land ownership, rules that changed in Brazil, that now a foreigner can no longer own land in the country. We've seen some changes around tariffs for some of the imported goods, you're right. However, I do believe that Brazil's reaction is quite aligned with what we see in the US or we see in Europe related to some of these agricultural tariffs. And I think we will see, especially this new government, which is intentionally wanting to be closer and closer to the US, I believe that this is going to drive a more positive relationship in the agricultural space also.
So, Oscar, I'd like to ask you a little more granular about investing in Brazil. And the key issue I want to speak about here is compliance and due diligence, particularly from the perspective of foreign investors coming into Brazil. So, I mean, when you're making investments in Brazil or other countries in Latin America where you're operating, can you speak about the conducting due diligence, what it involves from your perspective, why it's important, and perhaps what aspects are most critical in terms of your investment decision making?
It's a great point. I think it's interesting to view that Brazil, although is the eighth largest GDP country in the world, when we look related to doing business lists and rankings, Brazil is very, very bad on those rankings. It's a very hostile market. That's not very different to other South American countries also. And what does that mean? It means that there's a built-in bureaucracy that has made the doing business locally very hostile to foreigners, where you need to be always looking behind your shoulder related to who are the service providers that you're using for a certain activity. It could be as simple as a legal document notarization, or it can be a very strong financial due diligence. So what I see is that you cannot navigate the investment landscape unless you have a true local partner or a true local experience with feet on the ground that knows how to operate that. And I think for that matter, there are company and management companies, managers like ourselves, that have been specialized on helping international investors to come into the region. So we are born and raised, we live there, we have a whole team, we know the difficulties and we know the challenges that need to be addressed. And this is something that's a structural bureaucracy and structural issues that were built over the last decades and decades. And where I'm not talking about anything related to corruption, oh, you need to know who's this guy or that. No, that's not it. Mm-hmm. It's really knowing the tax infrastructure. It's knowing the process to open a company, the process to close a company, the labor laws, which are different in each one of the regions. So I believe that a international investor needs to have that kind of a very thorough due diligence and using local partners. We see also a very big differentiation between managers, well, these fund managers that are catering towards international investors and fund managers are catering towards local investors. They tend to have a very different compliance structure. Our case, for instance, we follow US SEC regulation to make sure that we have US level standards of compliance and structure, while a lot of our, let's say, local competitors that simply focus on local Brazilian money, they don't need to have any kind of SEC oversight. So I think this is something that for a general investor needs to look it with more detail.
What are some of the critical pitfalls or obstacles that you would advise foreign investors to be aware of coming into Brazil?
I think the first obstacle is the legal framework around ownership. It is very common for us to see documentation and see structures that were built in a way that didn't really provide to the foreign investor a true strong ownership that could be even executed in a case of a legal fight with whoever your local target company is. I think we've seen a lot of that happening. Also, I do believe that the framework of understanding where in specific regions, either if it's in Brazil or in Colombia or in other South American countries, which specific regions have the best or the worst tax impacts. That there's dramatic changes if you put your business either headquarters or investing through a specific state. And then when you're doing such investments, it's a really small handful of people or companies that have that level of expertise to understand which is the best path to do. So I think the two biggest hurdles are the tax impacts on your investments and ownership impacts when you're doing that. If you get that clear, I think the international investor will be a lot more protected. Fortunately, specifically, and this is more specifically towards Brazil, Colombia, Chile, government has never changed any law that affected a past ownership. So the last time we've seen a company being nationalized in these countries has been a long, long time. The case of Brazil, we have never had. Mm-hmm. So I think this is also something that's very important to understand. Sometimes certain countries, you take like Venezuela, for instance, has gone through that very recently, where you are an investor, you are an owner, but then the government simply kind of takes a hold of your assets.
So that brings me sort of my last two questions, Oscar, and that's, I want to ask you about the culture in Brazil and, you know, about the business culture in Brazil. Perhaps you can talk to me a bit about what it means to deal with Brazilians in Brazil and to invest in Brazil and to do business there. And then lastly, if you can tie in perhaps why Brazil, of all the emerging markets around the world where one could invest or do business, why Brazil?
The culture of investing in Brazil is very interesting. At the same time that most of the businessmen in Brazil and women, they have a very, let's say, positive capitalist mindset. There are certain cultural structures that were used in the past to reduce their costs that are quite complicated. So especially when we talk about labor laws and labor structures, we find a lot of companies that still don't pay their employees on the in accordance to the law and believe that that's very much a reality and true and that they shouldn't change that. Also, we see a very strong lack of interest on creating diversity in their businesses. We see a very strong lack of ESG standards. So what we try to do really is to, as a firm, is to bring this international mindset and standards, global standards, to these local businesses. So we look at environmental, social, governance, impact related type of measures. We look looked at diversity into these businesses to try and increase or increment to their culture this international mindset. But it's Brazilians and South Americans in general, very hardworking, and we see a lot of creativity in these businesses and in these entrepreneurs. And I think it's an amazing environment to invest in. So why Brazil? And maybe the best question is why Brazil now, right? We are living a moment globally that we've seen a lot of capital flow towards Asia. And now we're seeing a situation in Asia of a slower in their growth pace. We see Europe in a very sluggish growth stage, and with lots and lots of either fiscal issues and political issues of being able to negotiate situations like Brexit. We see in Africa a great opportunity, but still it's not a stable political and economic region. Maybe less than 10% of the region is in a stable situation.
Right.
But then when we look in regards to South America, of course, we have very unstable situations like Argentina, Venezuela. But we have countries that have done their homeworks in these last 10 years. And countries like Colombia, countries like Brazil, for instance, which is more than 80% of the GDP in the region, that have done a very strong political and economic homework in these last 10 to 15 years. And now what we see is a very stable environment for investments. It's so you take Brazil, for instance, in my opinion, the number one opportunity set right now, country, is a country that has lowest interest rates in history, lowest inflation in history, anchored inflation expectations. We've gone through a labor reform that reduced the risk for investors. We are going through the social security reform, which now is in its final phases of approval. And then what we're going to see now is a government that's very pro-market, creating situations where bureaucracy is going down, and it's allowing to have investments in very structural, low-risk type of sectors, like agriculture, but also energy distribution. And we're seeing a potential growth for the country in the years to come. I don't see it as a country that's going to grow 5-6% per year, but it's a country that will grow in this 2-4% range in this next 10 to 15 years, that it's a very great environment for investors to come into the country in this stage.
Once again, that was Oscar Decotelli, the co-founder and CEO of DXA Investments in Brazil. And I would like to thank Oscar for sharing his insights with us today. And thanks to you for listening. The Emerging Markets Podcast is produced by Pequod Advisory Group.